Good morning, everyone. I'm about to do something that my wife hates when other people do it, but I'm going to pre-warn you that I'm not feeling very good today. And as that usually happens, like at a restaurant, when someone says, it's my first night, and you're like, oh, great, this is going to suck. I just want to let you know that I'm feeling a little bit under the weather, so if I do pass out up here, it's nothing spiritual. It's probably just the flu. But here we go. Welcome to Epiphany Station. My name is Maddie. I'm the pastor here at Epiphany, and it is I'm just grateful that you chose to spend your time with us here this morning. It's been a pleasure, actually, through this entire summer to see lots of different people coming through and into the church to check out what we've been doing through the series that we've been pulling off over the summer. The series is called Under Construction. It's a whole summer-long series that we've been taking to really look at what it looks like to build and construct a solid, well-founded faith in knowing who God is, knowing who Jesus Christ is, and then building our lives around that. So we've been doing that, and really for the first kind of half of it, really up until the church in the park, a lot of what we were talking about in our messages was how to love God, how to relate to God, how to get to know Him better, how to get that relationship built. And then last week we kind of turned a corner, as now it's more directed about how to love people, how to engage in the real world circumstances we come across, with that love for God translating into an actual real love for people. So we've been going through this book called Colossians, written by a guy called Paul, who wanted to help churches and wanted to help young believers, old believers, all sorts of people who want to know God, know how to do that and how to do that well. Last week, as we kind of turned that corner into just getting real about how to love people, we shared a moment, I would say, those of you who were here. We actually kind of like one of those like therapeutic, you know, trust falls from a tree. We owned up to the fact that we're not perfect. And we got really specific about some of the things that are in our lives that we don't want to be there. Some of the stuff that we want to get rid of, that God wants us to get rid of. And, you know, we actually owned up to that stuff on the understanding that we would then do that. We would then get rid of it. Then we could then kill it and get rid of it. And that's kind of what we worked into last week, as Paul talked about how you actually do that, how you go ahead and you kill a sin as soon as you realize it's coming or you realize it's a part of your nature, how you kill it. And if you were here in the second worship experience, you might remember that killing stuff was so much a part of the message that I reminded people at the end to remember to go home and kill something. So imagine my relief when I found none of you in the newspaper this week citing me as the one who commanded you to commit murder. But last week, if you'd missed it, you can go back and find it on epiphanystation.com. It's under the watch tab along with the rest of the messages from this series. But we talked about getting rid of stuff last week. We talked about removing the things that don't belong. We didn't really touch on what to do next. I mean, you can't just improve by getting rid of bad stuff. You have to add in good stuff. You have to add in the fruitful, the beneficial stuff in its place. That's what we're doing this week. Because what we're going to talk about is, in all of this idea of getting rid of the evil stuff, the sinful stuff, we're now going to entertain the fact that God has some good stuff to put in its place. Some good things He wants to be a part of your character, a part of your nature, and a part of who you are and how you love Him and how you love people. So we're now talking about getting rid of the old, now talking about putting in the new. So we're going to dig into the Bible here in a second. We're going to be in Colossians if you want to follow along. This text will be on the screen behind me. If you don't have a Bible with you or own one that you understand, as you leave today, you can grab one from the Next Step station as a gift from us to you to do that. But we left off last week in Colossians 3:10. In which Paul said, now you need to understand, everyone, you need to put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. Basically leading us into this fact that we could understand and know who our God is, and we could actually be like Him. We could be like this Jesus Christ. And the real question is that actual life goal to aim for, or is that just a fairy tale? So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be going through verses 12 through 17 of chapter 3 to see if this is tangible, if this is real, if this is attainable, that we can do new life the way that God is talking about in here. So this is what Paul says in his next chunk, 12 through 17. He says, since God chose you to be the holy people He loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy and kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts, For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. Let the message about Christ in all of its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with the wisdom he gives. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Now, there's a lot in there. And actually, in there, there is the how we change, the what we change into, and the why it's worthwhile for us to do it. And that's how we're going to peg through it. We're actually going to take the middle, and we're going to take the beginning, and then we're going to take the end to see what Paul is really pushing at for us to become this new thing that God is interested in. So in 3:16, what actually Paul's saying is, let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. Now, one of the things that can be tricky for us to kind of understand as we come to know God is that how do you know more of God? And do you need to know more on God? Or is it kind of like, you know, one and done? I said the prayer, I got dunked, I'm golden. Or is there more to that? Well, what Paul is hitting on here is there is a thing for you to do now, if you call yourself a Christian, in which you take the message about Jesus Christ and you make it percolate. You make it trickle down and cascade into every single area of your life. The ESV, the English Standard Version, puts it nicely when it talks about letting the message about Jesus Christ dwell within you. Let it take residence. Let it take ownership. Let it actually get into the nooks and crannies. Does nooks and crannies translate? Yeah, okay, so the nooks and crannies, let it get in there. Let it actually get into the dark spots. Let it get into all those places that you don't want to actually change in, and let it do its work. So this good news that we've been talking about, this thing about, you know, your God loving you, your God sacrificing for you, your God making a way so you can know him, so you can be saved, so you can be made right, all those good things we've been talking about, our job is to let that sink in. Our job is to let that become the new thing that we're pouring into our lives, that we're filling up to the rafters with, as opposed to anything else. And that's where it begins. This is how life change actually starts. Because you can't just remove a bad thing and refill it with nothing. If anyone's ever struggled with addiction before or done anything in recovery ministries, you know you can't just take out a bad thing and leave a void there, because a bad thing is going to swoop straight back in. There has to be replacement. There has to be something good to fill the voids. And what Paul is saying is, you got to get the message of Jesus Christ in there. You got to get the good news in there. You got to get the gospel there. You got to get God's story. You got to get God's plan. You got to get what he says about you into your house, into where you dwell, so you can live with it. And really what he's talking about is, are you willing to let the message of Jesus Christ change your beliefs, change how you think, change what you actually act upon and how you do life? Because often we get it a little bit backwards. For a lot of us, when we're first introduced to Christianity or church or anything to do with Jesus, we kind of come into it, or it's been kind of portrayed to us, that you come into it with an idea of, first of all, you change your behavior. First of all, if you want to be part of this, you want to be accepted, you change your behavior to fit in. And then you can start maybe trying to make some good choices. And if you get around to it, we'll talk about core beliefs. It's so ridiculously backwards, because you can't put siding on a building that doesn't have a structure and a frame. Just like you can't fake Christ-like behavior when you don't have something structurally supporting and backing that up. So it has to start with the message of Jesus Christ getting into beliefs, coming up from the foundation and the root, and that being your structural support, that being the thing that you then hang the rest of your life on. Because when we take the truth of who God is, and let it change our beliefs, and let it change our decision-making process, then that will lead to behavioral changes. That will lead to the payoff, the money melon of Christian transformation, of actually being able to do life better and differently in a way that God would like, and heck, people would like you to do it too, because otherwise you tend to be a bit of a jerk. But what Paul is talking about is letting this message sink in. Let it fill up. And how do you do that? There are many different spiritual languages that can talk about how to get filled up, how to get topped up on the Spirit, how to really fill your life with God. Any of those is better than nothing, I'll be honest. I mean, as much as we struggle with, you know, how to do it, well, doing nothing is worse than doing something. It is not as complicated as we think when we talk about filling our lives with this message. Where did you hear the first of the message? Did you hear it from a person, Well, heck, maybe ask that person if they know some more. Did you read it in a book? Did you read it in the Bible? Did you hear it from church? Did you experience it in worship? I mean, where did you originally hear the message about Jesus Christ? Where did you originally learn to accept it as truth? Go back to that. Go to the thing that originally showed you that. And then explore these other things, like, I don't know, getting to know your Bible, where the message is, where you can find it. Putting yourself around church. And I don't mean like a Sunday morning event. I mean people. Putting yourself around people who want to go where you want to go, who want to go on the trajectory to know their God, to know their Creator and become like Him. Put yourself around them. Be willing, as Paul would say, to let them teach and counsel you. Let them give you advice on how to follow God. And heck, if someone asks you to give them advice, be ready to give them advice on how to do that. Put yourself in church. And then worship. Actually change your heart. Change how you view your God by actually changing your perspective on worship. I'll be honest, my first experience of worship is, when does this end? When will that guy stop singing so loud? And when can we leave? That was my first experience of worship. Come to Epiphany Station, pretty similar to start with. And then, oh, now I'm supposed to try and clap. Is it 1 and 3? Ben always told me it was 1 and 3, but now it's not 1 and 3. So when I'm gonna, all these things about the logistics of worship and completely missing the point. Worship is not just about music. Worship is not just about songs. In fact, worship is about the attitude that you carry into the rest of your life. So it can be in music. It can also be in digging a ditch. It can also be in paying your bills. It can also be in loving your family. Worship is about the attitude of the heart. It's the attitude of your core. And real worship changes that. Changes your attitude and actually makes you a thankful individual when you're worshiping in the right mind and aspect who your God is. So you can read the literal message of Christ in the Bible. You can get around people who know it and have experienced it and can walk alongside you. And you can do work to change the inside of who you are by growing in your thankfulness. And these things actually engaged in, and just trust me that this is not some sort of kind of cliche line. These things will work. These things will change you incrementally, day by day, week by week, year by year. And they will flood your life if you let them. They will fill your life with the message of Christ so that what we want to have happen can happen. Because most people, I'll be honest, don't come to church and don't come to God and be like, oh, I just want to be filled with the message of Jesus Christ. That's not how that conversation goes. Usually the conversation goes, my life sucks. I'm dumb. I'm making stupid decisions. I've wrecked this. I've done that. People are hurting me. What's wrong with the world? Where am I going? All these are the questions that they don't have to do with the message. They have to do with what the message can tell you. And if we want to have a different mindset, a different perspective, we want to be able to make different decisions, well, then it starts by laying that truth in, by filling up our lives with the message of Jesus Christ so that what we want to do, what people want us to do and need us to do, and what God wants us to do can actually happen. Going back into verse 12, Paul says, since God has done what he's done, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults. Forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts, for as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. The how we do it is that we let God invade our space, that we let him dwell with us, we let his message dwell with us, so that he can do what he needs to do. And we can do what we need to do because we must do these things. They do not become optional. And what's he really talking about? Tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, not being a jerk, knowing how to love people. If you wanted to boil down how to love people, this is a great starter. This is a great primer. And I'll ask you this, and it's kind of rhetorical, but you can shout out if you want to. Do you know anyone that you would say their primary distinctives are tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience? Like that's them in a nutshell. You may know someone. Don't put your own hand up. You may know now. You may know someone. You may know a few people that are like that if you're ridiculously lucky. You may know nobody like that. Because those characteristics are very rare, and they're becoming even more rare. And the reason that they're so rare is because they're not natural. The reason that they stand out when we see them from a stranger or from a loved one is because we deep down know that was difficult to do. That's not a normal behavior for a human being. In fact, they're so abnormal, you could call them supernatural. They don't naturally dwell inside of us, those things. The things that naturally dwell inside of us are the things we talked about last week. The swamp monsters, the things that want to wreck our lives. Things like evil desires, greed, anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, dirty language, and lies. Those things, all too natural, come out of the womb with that behavior. But this other stuff, this other list that Paul gives, that's hard work. That's not going to come without some intentionality. And the reason is, one of those lists, one from last week and one from this week, one of those lists is divine. The other one is deadly. One of those lists is God's plan. The other one is our perversion. Because you see, God has always intended for us to be like him, created in his image. And guess what he's like? He's tender-hearted, merciful. He's gracious. He's patient. He's kind. He's generous. The things, the best parts of us that have ever existed, exist because he laid that in us when we were created. The other stuff, we welcome in. We welcome in and we invite to be a part of who we are. And when it comes to change, when it comes to a life transformation that we actually want, at some point, God has to be able to remove the stuff that doesn't belong. And he has to be able to lay back in the stuff that he originally intended us to be. To turn us from a me-centered creature into a divinely inspired, heaven-bound child of God, he needs to turn us into what his sons and daughters are supposed to look like. He needs to turn us into what Jesus Christ exemplified and showed us what one of his true sons looks like. So that we're to do life differently by this, that we can love people, actually love people well. All those behaviors lead to our ability to do this in verse 13, to make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you because the Lord forgave you. Don't forget that. Forgiveness is the pinnacle and excellence of human behavior. To be able to say that I forgive the wrong that you've done, nothing you can do to fix it, nothing you can do to make it right, but I'm going to take your transgressions and move them to one side, is the best way we can learn to treat one another. And forgiveness is so rare and becoming all the more rare. I truly believe that you don't know how to forgive until you've been forgiven. I don't think that is naturally in our kids. I know a lot of adults that they don't know how to forgive. And the reason is when you don't understand forgiveness and having received it, I don't think you know how to give it. And if you've never been humbly, gently, mercifully, compassionately forgiven, you don't know how to do that. If you've never been completely forgiven of everything you've done wrong and said by someone that I still love you, you don't know how to replicate that. And God forgave first so that we could learn how to forgive. God took everything we did wrong and said, if you'll come and ask for it, forgiveness is yours. I'll forgive you and I'll love you all the more because you asked for forgiveness. When someone experiences that, when someone gets that, I truly believe that's when we can give that. When we learn that divine pinnacle of behavior of forgiveness and mercy and grace, that's when we can take that and make that a part of who we are. And no marriage, no relationship, no parenting relationship, no friendship, none of it can last without forgiveness. Because who here in this room is a screw up? Dang right you are. And if we cannot learn to forgive and we cannot make that a part of our behavior, relationships will fracture and they'll break and they'll diminish again and again and again. So God says, you must If you're going to be one of my kids, if you're going to have the audacity to call yourself Christian, if you're going to say that you're part of the same family as Jesus Christ, then you better learn that you must clothe yourselves in this way. This is who my family is. This is how we behave. I remember a story once before in which our old worship pastor, Ben Kishak, was telling me he was parenting his daughter, Mia. And it got to the point of saying, you know, we don't behave like that because we're Kishareks. And in our house, we don't behave like that because we're Tauses. This is how we do it. This is how we treat people. This is what God's saying. This is what he's saying. Is that rage, that anger, that malicious behavior, the slander, the lies, the greed? We don't do that. That's not in my house. We're Christians. We're little Christs. What I'm expecting from you is the mercy, the tenderheartedness, the compassion, the grace, the mercy, all of it, because that's how we do it. And then Paul goes on, as he gets towards the end of Colossians, to give us some good reasons why. Some good reasons why our behavior needs to change, why we have to let the truth in to change our decisions, to change our behavior. Three good reasons. And if you're a program follower and you're looking at the notes, which I rarely refer to, this is a good week for you to be in there because they're completely wrong because I changed everything after print. Dang nabbit. The first reason that we change our behavior, not the most important, but the first, is for us. Colossians 3:15 says, "And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts." It's a gift. It's a gift you can't get from anywhere else. The message of Jesus Christ being known to you is a gift you can't receive anywhere else, and it gives you dividends and payoffs like nothing else. Things like actual everlasting hope, giving you joy that's hard to kill, giving you peace when you need it. And this is the gift. This is where it begins. Selfishly, we change because we need to change. Because we can't sleep at night. Because we're not comfortable with what's going to happen when we die. Because we know we're not right with people. We know we're not right with God. And we need the gift of peace that comes from Christ. If we don't change that belief, if we don't let God tell us who we are now, who he is, and who people are in relation to those two things, our confidence won't change. Our confidence won't be able to shift into knowing that we're saved, knowing that we're forgiven, and we won't have peace. But it's not just for us, is it? Hopefully, I know you're not. I hope you know it's not just for us. And that's why it's not a choice. If it was God just throwing out gifts, he'd say, take it if you want it. But he's got a bigger plan going on with us being transformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. Because it's not just for us. When God gets a hold of me, when he got a hold of me and showed me his mercy and showed me his grace and gave me his forgiveness and all these other things, he wasn't done. He didn't say, now go be happy. Instead, there was a grander purpose at play, and whenever someone comes to know their God, sure, you get all that stuff up front and you get to grow in that and learn those things, and it's marvelous and fantastic getting the benefits of that relationship with your God. But if you stop there, you're missing the major point. You're missing the grander purpose of what's at play. Because the second reason that we get life transformation is for them. It's for those people. It's for those people who aren't in this room. It's for those people who don't know their God. It's those people that we know, that we interact with, that we have a relationship with, that we see daily, weekly, monthly, that don't know who their God is. It's for them. Colossians 3:16 says, "And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father." I don't find many Bible accounts of God changing somebody's life for their happiness. I don't see him picking up his people and setting them in comfort and just keeping them safe and protected. I don't see him taking people like Paul and Peter and Matthew and me and just saying, here you go. Here's everything I've got to give you. Go squirrel yourself away and wait for heaven. What I do find, account after account after account, is God saying, all right, get on your feet. It's time to work. It's time for you to go and do what I need you to do. Because when we learn how to love God, we learn how to have that relationship. Everything that follows that, everything that Paul talks about, that Jesus talks about, every behavioral change is now inextricably linked to, here's how you love people. you've got this love God thing, okay? Now let's do this love people thing, because there's a really good reason I need you to do that. Because for people to know our God, they don't need to be hit around the back of the head with a placard, and they don't need to have a Bible shaken in their face. What they actually need is compassion, kindness, love, patience, forgiveness. The things that will make a person stand out in their eyes as what's wrong with them. How are they able to do that for me? And the reason I believe this is because of an example in the last couple of weeks in which I'm walking with a guy and he's getting to know his God. I guess he puts down his sinful nature. He picks up God's new nature. He wants to get on mission. And the reason he decided to do that was not because somebody corrected his behavior. It was not because someone shouted a Bible verse at him. It is not because he came to Epiphany Station and the music was awesome or the teachings were good. The reason he cited that he gave God a chance, gave him any lick of a chance whatsoever to speak into his life, was you guys. He cited no less than 5 individuals who attend Epiphany Station as the reason he wanted to know who God was. People he'd known a long time, people he'd known a short time, people he knew in his workplace, people in his family. And he'd watched them for ages and seen something different in them. Seen their behavior not being like everybody else's. And then he found out there was a common factor. They had a relationship with God. And God had changed their behavior into this. And he gives credit and he cites people as being the reason he wanted to know who God was. And that's God's plan for the church. God's plan for the church is not a Sunday morning worship experience. God's plan for the church is for us to go out there and act like the church so people can see that life change is possible. We're not here to change the world. We're here to change lives. We're here to go and show people that God can actually do something. And nothing says that better than messed up, screwed up, jacked up you changing. Then God getting a hold of you and doing something different, something profitable, something beneficial, and people being blown away at seeing that. The third reason that we do it, the third reason that we must change, that we must let God change us, is for God's sake. Colossians 3:12 says at the beginning of our chunk today, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves. Chosen. Selected. For one reason or another, through your choice and through his, you have a relationship with God. Doesn't matter where it's at right now, but for some reason he got you here this morning and you have something, the beginnings, the middles, or the flourishing life of a relationship with God. Doesn't do that by accident and he doesn't do it by mistake. He does it for a purpose. And since he has chosen you to be one of his holy people, God did the choosing. God did the choosing. God did the selecting. One of the reasons that I think, honestly, we see fewer changed Christians than we really should is we think we're doing the heavy lifting. Like we made the relationship with God happen. And, you know, honestly, it's because we say stuff like, I said yes, or I let Jesus in, and things like that, which makes it sound like it's us. But we wouldn't be doing any of that if God had not been bashing on the door for the last couple of decades of our lives. We would not be having a relationship with God if he had not made a way. We are simply responders. He did the choosing. He did the work. He paid the ransom so that we could come back to know him. And he made the way and we chose, or we will choose to walk down it. If we don't understand that God chose and God did the heavy lifting and God did the work and we simply responded, we'll only really make change about how we feel we need to change. Because we won't fully appreciate that there's something we should be doing with our life in response to give back to God for what he's done. And our change will happen slowly, incrementally, in some of the areas that we want it to happen. And the difference between how God wants you to change and how we're comfortable changing is the difference between a mile and a meter. For those of you who are metric literate, you knew what that meant. But God's plan, and the reason that we have to do it for God's sake, is that he plans to take a bunch of misfits, call them his holy people, his set apart people that he's made his family, and then throw them back out into the world. To throw them back out into the world so one day a childhood friend of yours can see you 10 years later, 20 years later, say, what happened? We were all sure you'd be dead by now. You can have people walking by you in the hallway, seeing a smile on your face for no good reason whatsoever. That where you work would be your opportunity to show that God can change lives. And the reason he pulls the misfits together, the reason he pulls such a diverse group together, is he wants people in DigiKey. Yeah, amen. Dark, lost plate now. We won't be broadcasting that. He wants people in DigiKey. He wants people in Arctica. He wants people in Sanford. He wants people at Hardware Hank. He wants people everywhere. He wants people nestled into the world that they live in, showing that something is now different, showing that God has done something in their lives. Not to look good, not to show off, but to actually give people hope that there is change at hand. God also wants a person in your home showing that. He wants a mother showing that, a father showing that, a child showing that. He wants someone in the home saying, God can do this for our entire family. He wants that in a marriage. He wants somebody leading the way to say, this is what God can do for our marriage because he's done this to me. And honey, you know how screwed up I am. He wants us to do this. Who are we to say no? If we truly understand how forgiven we are and what he's done for us, who are we to turn around and say no? So if we want behavioral change, we want life transformation, we want things to go differently, it has to start with filling our lives with the entire message of Jesus Christ. And then it looks like doing what he's called us to do by clothing ourselves in a new nature in what Christ would do with life, with your life. And then to be willing to tell people why something has changed, why something is different. Our role has always been clear in the Bible, the job of the church, the job of Christians. Paul wrote in another place in 2 Corinthians. Either way, Christ's love controls us. Since we believe that Christ died for all, we also believe that we have all died to our old life. He died for everyone so that those who receive this new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ who died and was raised for them. And all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ, and God has given us the task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them, and he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. And a life that is characterized by Christ-likeness screams, come back to God. In no better way does it scream, come back to God. That this is what he can do with your life. This is what he's done with mine. So as a believer, if you're a believer, are you willing to accept that mission that those who come into contact with you need you to represent? Need you to show off who your God is so that they have a chance of seeing that they would be welcome in that family? Are you willing to be part of someone's story? When they recount their journey towards knowing their God, is your name going to be on the list of it's because of them? It's because of how they behaved. It's because of how they treated me, how they forgave me, how they showed me kindness, how they showed me patience. Do you want to be on that list? If you do, start acting like you want to be on those people's lists. Christ's likeness and our bearing of it, it's for our own peace. It is for our own world. And it is to do for our God. Because people need to see that church is more than wine and crackers. They need to see that if they're feeling powerless, if they're feeling hopeless, if they don't feel like they can turn the ship around, if they feel like they're done and they're just going to grin and bear life and keep their head down, if they're going to just go through marriage, go through parenting, go through work, and never, ever fully experience what God has for them, then it's our job to show them something different. Would you guys please pray with me for that? Father God, I ask that you'll challenge us to do that. carry a metaphorical badge that says ambassador. That we don't be under the understanding that when we live life, people are seeing an example of you. We know we're not perfect. We know we're not always going to get it right. But God, we want to know. We want to know that you're working through us. We want to know that you're going to change us. We want to know that we can have that, that our people around us can have that. Help us to show the hopeless. Help us to show the broken. Help us to show everyone in our lives that there's more to it. God, if anyone here is in that place of hopelessness and they're looking for that, I ask that you'd show that to them. That you show them your message, that they don't understand your message, that they would, that they'd have a church around them. That they would have people that would be around them willing to care for them, to show them compassion, to show them mercy in the way that you've shown to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One last thing before we move on to the last worship song. I want you to take your connection card. Everyone got a program or they should have when they walked in. I want everyone to hold it up so I can see 200 of these. That would be a lot for the 100 people that are in here. Anyway, I want you to take the slip of paper on the right-hand side that hopefully yours was perforated better than mine. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to take ownership. If you're a Christian, if you assign and attribute to yourself that you're a part of God's family, I want you to write three names. Can be first names, can be initials, couldn't care less. I want you to take ownership of three names that you are going to work to be an ambassador to those people. Like I said, not throwing a Bible at them, but actually loving them. That you're going to aim to be on their list because they don't know their God yet. Three people in your life that one day, if they know their God, are going to cite you as a reason that they do, because you decided to be the church, because you decided to clothe yourself in tender-hearted mercy, patience, kindness. And that way we can go about changing lives. You can take that connection card, and if you're willing to jot your name down on it, that'd be superb, and you can put anything else down on here you want. You can drop them in the red boxes at the end of the aisles as you're leaving today. Those red boxes are where we also receive any kind of offering. You'll notice we don't pass a plate here at Epiphany, but instead for people who do give and want to support the mission of Epiphany and give their gifts to God here, they know they can do that in the two red boxes if it's cash and check. We have a card reader out by the iPad and the Next Step station. You can also give online. But as we worship together, I want you to really consider your role, where you're at, what your relationship with God is like, whether you need to accept the truth of the message, whether you need to be someone who's showing the truth of the message. And as we worship, you would let this worship music, you would let this song, you would let your response be genuine. And Cody.